Welcome everybody. We are recording this seminar and our guest today after the last minute change is Professor Gerald Henler. Unfortunately, the originally appointed speaker could not make it because of the health problems, but we are very lucky to have Gerald together with us today and he will present very similar topic, but the title is different. The title is Enigmatic Maia Variables and Impossible Class of Pulsating Stars. Let me just tell a few words about Gerald. He's a full professor at Nicolaus Copernicus Astronomical Center. He did PhD in the University of Vienna, 1999. And for many years he worked as a postdoc and later as a tenure track. And finally he received a professorship and works since then in Copernicus Center. He's interested in stellar astrophysics, pulsations of stars and asteroseismology. He serves off for the bright satellite project as a member of this steering committee. So that's basic information about Gerald, and please tell us about Maia variables now. Welcome.
Okay, thanks. Thanks everybody for having me. I should say that I decided to put into a different topic to give the original speaker a chance maybe to present her results at a different occasion, if possible. So I would like to tell you about some interesting, maybe a little curious situation among the field of pulsating stars, namely the so-called Maia variables that seem to be a class of pulsating stars, or that has been proposed that actually shouldn't exist. And the question is why. And we've made a couple of recent investigations also in that topic, together with my previous postdoc, Phyllis Karaman. And we've recently, a couple of weeks ago, submitted a paper to the publications of the Astronomical Society of Australia on this topic. And this is also the subject. Or will contain the most of the things about the direct subject that I'll be telling you about. But let's start at the beginning. I would like to give you a more basic introduction because I know that not everybody is an astronomer here. So let me just give you a couple of definitions, namely, what is a variable star? What do we consider a variable star? And the variable star is a star whose brightness varies periodically, semi-periodically, irregularly, and so on. But all these changes would happen on a time scale that is observable by humans. So that means, for instance, brightness changes caused by stellar evolution when a star evolves along the main sequence that are logical and natural. This does not fall under the definition of variable stars. So it's some kind of short period phenomena. So on timescales of, I would say, hundreds of years and less. There's lots of different groups of variable stars, and they are classified, first of all, historically, into different classes, and later it has turned out that the classification of those stars usually is based on a definite physical reason. So the phenomenological differences that we see actually do have a physical background. Okay, so why are those stars interesting? What I would say is that by the analysis of variable stars, and I'm into pulsating stars, then even more so, we can get information on stellar parameters that we cannot get any other way, especially about the interior structure of the stars, but also We can, of course, get some measures of mass, radius, luminosities, distance, temperature, and so on, that we can compare with other determinations of these quantities. And by combining all these different kinds of information, we can learn more about the stars and build more accurate physical models of those stars, of course, and by inference of stellar systems, because, of course, galaxies and so on, they're all made up of stars. Okay, talking about variable stars, and this is important for what comes later. That's why I also decided to spend a little time on that. There's different types of variability of variable stars. We roughly distinguish intrinsic and extrinsic variables. Intrinsic variability means that the variation of a star or the stellar brightness is due to physical changes in the star or in the stellar system when we have more than one star. So for instance, pulsating variables, and here's an animation of a pulsating variable on the top right. So a star that periodically changes its size and temperature, and therefore, of course, the output flux that we observe is modulated as a change in light. Or for instance, eruptive variable, closed binaries, where we have mass transfer, and we sometimes see outbursts, for instance, due to this mass transfer, or caused by this mass transfer. The second group would be extrinsic variables. So that's variability that's due to the eclipse of one star by another. An example here of a closed binary, where sometimes one star is covered by the other, or the other star covers part of the other star. And this also gives brightness changes because of the different, because of geometrical projection effects into our line of sight. Another important type of variability, extrinsic variability, is stellar rotation. So that means that stars have surface spots on them that could be either cool spots for cooler stars or magnetic abundant surface spots for hotter stars. And therefore, we would see variability on the timescale of the rotation period of the star, which we can obviously measure then. Now, when I'm talking about oscillating stars, one may ask oneself, how can a star oscillate at all? And one very, very rough analogy we can use by basically looking at a piston like in a car engine, so that if you would just have some gas inside the combustion chamber or in the chamber where the piston compresses, the weight of the piston is counterweighted by the gas pressure. So if you're putting the piston in, then the gas pressure exerts a force in the other direction. I don't need to explain physicists. And we have, so to say, this is the equilibrium state of a star. The gravity and the pressure force in a non-pulsating stars are in equilibrium. However, I mean, if we have an ideal gas and no like energy losses in that system, if we let the piston fall down onto the gas chamber, then it will start jumping up and down. And so the gas acts like a perfect spring, and we get periodic oscillations. But of course, life is not that easy. So if we have non-perfect heat isolation, then we get damped oscillations. So an oscillation will start and then get damped out. And this is what usually happens in stars that are in equilibrium, so that even if an external force acts on that star, and it would start to oscillate, and the oscillations will damp out after some time. So we need some mechanism that keeps the oscillations going in pulsating stars, because obviously, I mean, such stars exist, we observe them, so there's got to be a reason for that. And time principle are two very basic mechanisms. There's more than that, but there's no need to go into detail here. For instance, the so-called epsilon mechanism for the maintenance of pulsations. So that means that if you have a nuclear burning region inside the star, you compress that, the temperature goes up, the nuclear energy generation becomes more efficient, we generate more energy, the star needs to expand, nuclear energy generation goes down, and it contracts again. So we would have a possibility to maintain oscillations in a star. Actually, the epsilon mechanism, there has been no observational confirmation of the existence of any kind of pulsations driven actually by the epsilon mechanism. And actually, the original speaker of this seminar has also made some investigations in that, and actually also was able to show that previous like claims of epsilon driven pulsations were actually in error. Anyway, probably the most important mechanism is the so-called Kappa mechanism, and it works on stellar opacity. So that means in certain regions of the star, in particular in regions where we have partial ionization of the gas that's inside the star, when we put additional energy in a region that where we have partial ionization, the energy gets actually used to in the ionization process, and so the energy can be stored in that certain region of the star. And then when the star or that layer of partial ionization again tries to get into equilibrium and gets expanded and expands, of course the temperature drops, the ionization recombination occurs, and the energy can dissipate towards the outside, and then the whole cycle starts again. And so this is basically the Kappa mechanism, that energy that's created in the stellar interior is stored periodically in certain regions of partial ionization inside stars. Okay, so that Kappa mechanism, for instance, occurs in several possible regions in a given star. So this is a diagram of depth inside a star, temperature, and the opacity coefficient kappa. And there are several important ionization regions in the inside of stars associated with metals. So we astronomers call, of course, all elements heavier than helium metals. So this is the so-called metal ionization region, which occurs at about temperatures of 200,000 Kelvin. Then we have the ionization region of helium, helium-1 to helium-2, which is in at temperatures of about 45,000 K. And we have the helium-1 ionization zone that occurs at temperatures of about 10,000 K. Most important in real stars are those first two ionization zones where pulsations can be driven. Now, obviously, if energy is stored in certain regions, that does not necessarily mean that that this energy really can excite observable pulsations in a star, because, for instance, the ionization region might be too close to the stellar surface. So, for instance, for very hot stars, the helium-2 ionization region is so close to the surface that there's not enough material on top of it that can be made to oscillate to an observable amplitude. And of course, if the driving mechanism is too deep inside the star, then then the energy is not enough to lift the regions on top of the star. At this point, I would like to make a very quick sidestep. Of course, we astronomers, and this will be important for the rest of this talk as well. We astronomers classify stars in a so-called Hertzsprung-Russell diagram. So this is plotted we have on the x-axis some type of temperature indication, spectral type or effective temperature. Interestingly, temperature increases from right to left. And on the y-axis, we have a luminosity indicator, absolute magnitudes or luminosities when computing theoretical models. And in this diagram, very important is the so-called main sequence. This is where most stars are located, and they are located in a sequence of mass. So the hottest and most massive stars are on the top left, and the coolest stars are on the bottom right. And then we have some giant branches and also some supergiant stars, so evolved stars that have evolved off the main sequence, and a large region of white dwarf stars. And what I would like to mostly talk about are main sequence stars, but also a little bit of evolved stars. But the main subject of this talk is actually pulsations on the main sequence. As I said before, the layer where the Kappa mechanism operates should not be located too deep into the star, inside the star, not too high inside the star. That, of course, means, since these layers have certain temperatures, that these stars that are able to pulsate will all have a certain set of characteristics that are similar to them. And this manifests itself in a so-called pulsational instability strip in this HR diagram, where we actually see a strip of stars, or a strip in this region where stars are located that pulsate. And depending on what kind of driving mechanism we see in those different stars, we have different instability strips in this Hertzsprung-Russell diagram. The classical instability strip, where the famous pulsating stars like Cepheids, Arrollare variables, all these good distance indicators are located, are associated with the ionization region of helium-1 to helium-2. Now, for a more schematic representation of this Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, here's the zero H main sequence, so where stars start to burn hydrogen in the interior. I've also indicated a couple of stellar evolutionary tracks here for solar-like mass, post-main sequence evolution, pulsating white dwarf stars, and so on. And I've also marked here different areas where we find different classes of pulsating star. The classical instability strip is here. And we find different classes of pulsating stars, gamma Dorado stars, Rho P stars, delta Scuti stars, and so on. I'll explain that in a little bit. And we also have instability strips further up the main sequence, off the main sequence, for evolved stars, and so on. But these are all distinct, and they're all, or most of them, contain one and a single classes of pulsators. You also see some overlaps. So here in these regions, we actually see stars that have more than one different kind of pulsations. I'm excited, but not of central importance here. There's a big zoo of these pulsating stars. I do not expect you to remember that, but just to tell you, the cooler pulsators, depending on where they are in the HR diagram, they can have pulsation periods of several years, up to 3 years for long period variables. down to minutes for stars that oscillate like our sun on the main sequence. The subject of this talk will be more massive pulsators on the main sequence, and the four important groups here I have pointed out. These are here on the main sequence, the gamma dorados pulsators. These are slow pulsators, pulsating in gravity modes. I will not explain the different kinds of oscillations here. That it's just suffice to say that these so-called gamma dorado stars pulsate with periods of about one day, and the amplitudes are a few millimagnitudes. A millimagnitude is about 1/1000th of the modulation in mean flux that we receive from the star. So these are pulsation amplitudes below a percent usually in mean light. The Delta Scuti stars, they're a little bit more massive and a little bit hotter. They are actually located where the classical instability strip intersects the main sequence. So these are helium-1 kappa mechanism driven pulsators. They have periods between about 20 minutes and 8 hours. They have amplitudes basically down to any possible detection level that you can get, up to like 50 millimagnitudes, 5%. Some of them can even have like 30% amplitude. Very few ones, excuse me. So these are located here. Further up the main sequence, we have the slowly pulsating B stars. These are again slow pulsators, periods of few days, amplitudes also a few millimagnitudes, so below a percent approximately in amplitude. And then completely or even further up, we have the so-called beta Cephei stars that have pulsation periods between 3 and 8 hours and amplitudes also down from whatever detection level to 50 millimagnitudes. And you see there's, and I should say that those two classes of pulsating star, they are associated with the partial ionization in so-called metals. So iron peak elements actually. So these are hotter pulsators and the pulsation is excited than deep layers of the star. What's also important or interesting to remember here, so we have a group of slowly pulsating stars driven by the similar mechanism as a group of more rapidly pulsating stars. Then here we have a gap because there's no driving mechanism operating in here. Then we again have some slow variables and some more rapid variables. Okay. So much for an introduction, and now going to the so-called Maia variables. Even almost 70 years ago, as first Otto Struve has proposed that actually one of the brightest members in the Pleiades cluster, the star Maia, is a pulsating variable. He claimed to have discovered rapid oscillations with timescales of about tens of minutes in this star, proposed that this could be a new type of variables. I should say that at this time when Struve made this discovery, this slowly pulsating B stars and beta safe slowly pulsating B stars were not yet known. So this was just in the gap between the Delta Scuti stars and the beta Cephei stars. Struve himself 2 years later retracted that claim and said that on the basis of new measurements, no, I cannot confirm the variations of Maia. But this has somehow stayed in the literature, and there have been reports every couple of years or every couple of decades of pulsations actually here in the gap between the Delta Scuti stars and the slowly pulsating B stars. This is from one such paper by Holger Lehmann collaborators. They have analyzed radial velocity observations of a bright star gamma corona borealis, and apparently found a period of about 2.5 hours or 2 hours in the radial velocity of that star, and that star is also too hot to be a delta Scuti star, too cool to be a slowly pulsating B star. Period is too too short for a slowly pulsating B star, and therefore this was another candidate. And such reports have turned up a couple of times. Since the advent of space photometry, so where we have space telescopes that can obtain very, very high precision photometry, this topic has returned into the literature, and interestingly, in a study based on the Kepler space telescope, of very bright stars, Tim White and collaborators a couple of years ago has studied actually the seven brightest members of the Pleiades, and Tim and collaborators found that actually Maia itself is not a Maia variable. There's no rapid pulsations, but what they found is that the star seems to have surface spots, and its variability is caused by rotational modulation on a 10-day time scale, but no short period pulsations in that star. So if we had a group of Maia variables, then the prototype would not be a member of this class, just for curiosity. But how can we explain that there would be stars between those two instability strips where there's no pulsation mechanism known? Some kind of explanations, or a couple of explanations, came up in the literature. For instance, that if we had a slowly pulsating B star that rotates really rapidly, then projection effects could modify the oscillation frequencies to a higher value that could imply that due to projection effects, that the observed period is shorter than it really is in the rest frame of the star itself. Based also on Kepler photometry, Peter Krode and collaborators found some stars that are also in this gap, but then there were some stars that are really intense galactic fields. So these stars were heavily reddened. And so the position of those stars in the HR diagram was not really very well known, so they could be something else. Based on ground-based photometry, Nami Movlavi and collaborators found some stars that are called fast-rotating pulsating B stars, and they were closer into that gap as well. But they also conclude in their paper, and that's why I copy-pasted it from that paper, that basically the definition of this new variability class does not imply the need for a new pulsation mechanism, but there must be some different physics to excite pulsations outside the borders of the known instability strips. I should say also that none of these variables that have been discussed in those previous papers show these really rapid oscillations on timescales of the delta Scuti star. So we're not talking about timescales of like an hour or something. We're still talking about the timescale of several hours. Some other attempts to explain that variability within the region where it shouldn't be. So here's an theoretical HR diagram using models, where we here have the main sequence indicated. This is the hot border of the delta Scuti instability strip, the red border of the slowly pulsating B star instability strip. here in this area, there should be no pulsators. Sebastian Salmon collaborators showed, for instance, that if you have a star that's rapidly rotating, and if you see that star equator on, then due to the flattening of the star due to the rapid rotation, the star will appear cooler in the equatorial regions and hotter near the poles because of the geometrical deformation. And therefore, if you see that star equator on, it may appear cooler than it really is. And therefore, it might show up actually in this gap as a variable star due to geometrical projection effects of the way we see that star. But as you can see, this applies to maybe like half the size of that gap, but we would not be able to explain stars down here. Another explanation by Don Kurtz and collaborators is also some kind of projection effects. He's found several stars. So this is a theoretical Fourier spectrum. We see the pulsation spectrum of the star in frequency versus amplitude space. So each vertical line you see in here is actually a single pulsation of that star. It's a multi-periodic pulsating star. And this star has some frequency groupings. This is the main frequency group. That's the real pulsations, frequencies. But we also see here some low pulsation frequencies that are actually frequency differences here in this group. And here we see another group of some frequencies, frequencies that are sums of those in the basic group that imply higher frequency. And it can be that due to other geometrical projection effects that it's actually those groups with these so-called harmonic frequencies attain higher photometric observed amplitude than the basic group of pulsations that have the correct frequency. So we may see stars that appear to pulsate in frequencies higher than they really do. And that's another possible pulsation. Explanation. Very recently, also together with Don Kurtz, we actually found one star that we have lots of spectroscopy and other data on, that we found that it had one single rapid oscillation. It's located in that gap, but we could show that this single oscillation is actually coupled to other oscillations of lower frequency. We see in that star that should be there. So that means that we do not need a special or a kappa driving, a new pulsation mechanism to explain this high frequency oscillation. We can explain that by a coupling between other oscillations that are excited inside that star. A second short detour, because I mean the keyword has already been mentioned here, using TESS data, because everything that follows now will be used on data from the TESS mission. Just a few words about the TESS mission. TESS mission is a current NASA space mission that monitors the whole sky in the search for extrasolar planets. Extrasolar planets of usually Neptune size and larger, and it makes a survey of the whole sky by observing 24 times 96 degree fields for 1 month each, and then moving on to the next field. So it maps basically the whole sky and tries to find short period relatively large planets that way. And this mission, because this is an all-sky survey, produces also extremely valuable and highly precise data for pulsating stars. And since the data are not proprietary or anything, everybody can download them, then this is, of course, a great mining area for variable star astronomers. And people have, of course, made great use of these test data. Among them, also some people who have looked at those so-called Maia stars. There was a paper in 2020 that examined this question, and they found 131 stars in test data that are apparently located inside that gap. And then later on, very recently, the first author of this paper also proposed even 493 stars with high frequencies that are not explicable by any kind of pulsational driving. So that, of course, is a significant number, and it cannot be interpreted away that easily. But to say it provocatively, can we possibly interpret it away? So because of these claims, my postdoc or my previous postdoc, Felice, and I, we decided to look at those stars that have been claimed, actually in this first paper, because the second one came later. And we selected a sample of 31 of these 131 stars for deeper examination. And this is just the theoretical Hertzsprung-Russell diagram of these 31 stars. Here's the hot edge of the delta Scuti instability strip. That's the slowly pulsating B-star instability strip. And these are the effective temperatures and luminosities derived by Bologna and Osuyar. We made high-resolution spectroscopy of these stars. We made the model atmosphere analysis. We determined accurate effective temperatures of those stars. We used Gaia data to determine their luminosities. And so we placed those stars also in an HR diagram. And our result looks like this. So we have lots of stars that are now inside this delta Scuti instability strip. We have a couple of stars that are in the beta Cephei instability strip. And we have a few stars that are in the slowly pulsating B-star strip. And there's a handful of stars left in that gap. So most of these stars that came in this paper can actually be explained in a different way as a new group of variable stars. Going more into that, one of the problems with or difficulties with test photometry is that this is an all-sky survey, and the fields of view are extremely large, as I showed you before. So that means that one pixel on the test detector covers 21 arc seconds on the sky. So that means that often you can have more than one star in a given photometric aperture. And so you could receive, for instance, the signals of more than one star in one data set. And this can, of course, if you have different types of pulsating star just by accident, and since this is an all-sky survey, I mean, there's lots of stars, so such accidents can occur. So one needs to really check of whether the signal that we find in those light curves or in those data are really associated with the star that we think it comes from. So we made a so-called blending analysis. There are tools for that to check whether there are some issues of that in that respect. And we found actually one star that actually did have a blending issue. Where the signal came from a different star close by. I have made plots of the Fourier spectra, so amplitude versus frequencies of all those stars, and I have, knowing our results, tried to classify the variability and then used our results to classify the variability of those stars, also with the pulsation in the HR diagram. So these are the Fourier spectra we see of these 31 stars that we examined. And here are my variable star classifications. And so if we look at those stars now more accurately, we have lots of delta Scuti stars. So normal known types of pulsating stars. So we just remove them from the sample. We're left with a little bit more than half of the stars. We do see a couple of beta Cephei stars. So stars that obviously had incorrect effective temperatures in the original study. So we removed those. Then we have some slow variables, slowly pulsating B stars that only show slow variations and no rapid variations, as would be the definition of those so-called Maia stars. So remove those. Then we have a star that's an internal gravity wave variability. We have a star that had this blending issue where we had a binary star of W Ursae Majoris type in the background that seemed to imposter the pulsating star. And then we also have slowly pulsating B stars with those combination frequencies that I explained before, where there is just frequency combinations of slower pulsations that appear to make up more rapid oscillations. So we remove those. We remove the other stars that are incorrectly classified. We're left with 4 stars out of 31. Okay. All these stars are kind of also peculiar. For instance, this is a rapidly oscillating B star that probably has a component of delta Scuti type. Then we have a rotational variable, probably without delta Scuti type. Here we probably have a binary of an SPB star, the delta Scuti type. And here we have a rotational variable of the mercury manganese type, of which 90% of those stars are actually binaries. This is known from the study of other variables. That's also from the Gaia database. There's a so-called Ruwe parameter, random unit weighted error. If this parameter is above 1.4, it basically gives you the ratio of the scatter of individual parallax measurements over the mean, weighted with the error of the determinations. And if this parameter is above 1.4, then you can be very sure that this is actually an astromatic binary. So here we very likely have two types, two pulsating stars or two types of variable stars in a binary. And if it's above 1.2, we can suspect that this is actually also a binary. So I think if we want to interpret away, as I said earlier, intrinsic pulsation in those stars, we can actually do that for all 31 stars that we have in our sample. We can explain all of them in a different way. Okay, and so this is the summary and the conclusions of this study. So we made high resolution spectroscopy, blending analysis, variability classification of 31 of those stars. All of them we can explain without invoking self-excited pulsations and being located where no self-excited pulsations are expected to be present. We know that the hypothetical now group of Maia variables, I mean, even doesn't have a valid prototype. In my opinion, it doesn't even have a single confirmed member. And so The proposal that we make in this paper that I'm basically reporting about is that the designation Maia variable should be avoided because it's misleading in several respects that are listed just above here. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention and make a little announcement and advertisement that this story is to be continued, because I have a couple of more ideas of how to investigate this question. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gerald. This was a fascinating seminar for me and like a crime story. So you search for a suspect and then you find nobody. So there was no crime, right? Okay, I would like to open discussion, and I see already hands up. First, Bożena Czerny. Please ask question.
Okay, my question is relatively simple. How stable are those pulsations, in the sense that if you go to the same star after 2-3 years, do you see exactly the same situation, or it changes with time? I mean, in the time scale of few years.
It depends what kind of class of pulsating star it is, but as you already suspected, it's, for instance, the more shorter period pulsating stars like the Delta Scuti stars, changes in the pulsational spectra are actually relatively common. As has been documented, for instance, in 4 years of Kepler data. Whereas for other types of pulsating stars, for instance, the beta Cephei stars, they seem to be relatively stable, although the pulsation periods are not that much longer. So yes, it does occur. We do not exactly why it occurs, but because I mean the physics behind this is really complicated. But there are very few cases, or actually I can remember only one where actually pulsations would have gone completely away or reappeared in a star. So those stars that pulsate, they change, they are always variable, but, and then you often the frequencies, the individual oscillations are the same, but the amplitudes change. But sometimes new ones pop up or go away or so.
Okay,
thank you.
Yeah, any other questions? Please rise, Leonid.
Hello, thank you for your talk. I have a question, maybe not relating directly to your talk, but still it's interesting for me as a theorist. So let's, for example, we consider a single pulsating star like Maia, right? And if we consider a classical Kepler's problem for the planet motion or comet-like bodies, scattering of comet-like bodies for such stars, does it have any effect and on the motion of the bodies within the Kepler's problem? And does it? I mean, this pulsation. Well, excuse me, I'm not a specialist in this field, but considered more like a theorist. Does it pertain? I mean, this pulsation pertains to luminosity, or there must be also some mass redistribution which may affect actually motion, Kepler's problem motion. Of course, if you have a binary star, then we have a three-body problem, and it's even more complicated, right? But in the case of single star, especially if they're elliptic shapes, so it might be important.
Yes, that's actually a very good point. Yes, because these since we do have motions on the stellar surface, of course we do see a change in the radial velocities that could be misinterpreted for a Keplerian motion. But for instance, the pulsation periods, they are usually much shorter than the orbital timescales of whatever planet, comet, and so on. But people have actually also taken advantage of that, and they have actually used changes in the arrival times of the short period pulsations to detect binary companions from just a change in the lifetime effect of the pulsations. So this can actually be, I mean, this can be like separated, but also combined.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, other questions? No, maybe I will ask just a general question about observations. You are using now this test data, but I guess there are many more satellite missions devoted to observing the variable stars, such as Bright, for instance. You are involved in this collaboration. So are they more suited with this field of view, for instance, to avoid the problem of the field of view and stars which are accidentally observed as a variables and they are not variables intrinsically?
Yeah, I mean, each of these missions has its pluses and minuses. The plus of TESS is that it's really an all sky survey. So you get data for millions and millions of stars. TESS is also a larger telescope, for instance, than Bright, so the data are more precise for the fainter stars. So the samples you're working with are much larger. And then, of course, I mean, you have better possibilities to pull out interesting objects. Whereas Bright, for instance, is specialized in that effect, in that sense that it looks at the brightest stars in the sky. It does not have so much download capability as TESS, that is run by NASA, and we are running at some quasar. So that means that for Bright, the total amount of stars that have been observed is about 700. It has other advantages, for instance, that we do have multi-filter cutting capabilities, so we can study temperature variations and so on. So the short answer is it really depends on what kind of science you want to do. The data from one mission is better suited for some science case and for the other mission for other science cases.
Okay, yeah, it's good opportunity for students also to learn using different data samples. One more point is actually from theoretical side, because we actually with Bożena also we worked on the instabilities of the accretion disks with a very similar mechanism, that is the partial ionization of the hydrogen, and these opacity tables are very important, yeah, in this theoretical explanation. So does your work depend much on this opacity values? They are probably sensitive to the tables, or
yes, how is that? For me, it's convenient because I'm an observer, so I can say this is what the star is telling me, and then I can talk, for instance, to Jagoda Dashinska in Wrocław, who is making those model kind of computations, whether she can reproduce it. But the thing, for instance, is for these hot stars that I'm mostly interested in, we still cannot fully explain the range of pulsation frequencies that we see. We have no ideas about amplitudes, but the pulsation frequency ranges actually tell us about the strength of the driving and where some driving must be. And from these examinations, we actually learn that the opacity tables that we're using, they are still not perfect. And we know that we do need, we do require larger actually iron peak element opacities to explain the pulsations in those hot stars.
I see.
Iron is always, if I can add, iron is always a problem. It's far from perfect.
Yeah, in our case, it's probably nickel that's crucial.
Uh-huh.
But nobody's done the calculations yet, I think.
All right. Mm-hmm. I see one more hand up from Centrum Fizyki Teoretycznej, the host.
I just have a naive question about the intrinsic oscillation of a star. So when we assume the star is just fluid, you should not have oscillation, right? I mean, there is some kind of like critical phenomena due to the composition of a star, like atomic reaction or nuclear reaction. But if you just consider like a simple fluid mechanics, when you have a pressure, and how can we have an oscillation? You cannot, we are not supposed to have an oscillation, right?
Well, the stars that they are not that homogeneous, so that means you you have a temperature gradient in the interior, you have pressure gradients and so on. Of course, the stars produce nuclear energy in the interiors, and then you have these different layers of different ionization regions. You do have radiation forces that redistribute the chemical elements that are inside the stars. So stars are not that simple, and so therefore these mechanisms can exist, because the interior structure of those stars are just more complicated than that.
I think the problem is that you have this additional heating, so the star is more like a kettle with boiling water on and the cover, and the cover jumps, right? Because when you boil the water, it will jump.
Yeah, that's a very good analogy. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And last chance to ask question to Gerald, whoever wants to ask. This was very pedagogical seminar and also quite impressive results. So both, it's a pleasure to hear this seminar. If there are no more questions, we should wrap up the meeting. You can still send questions to me, and I will forward them to Gerald if you think of something later. Unfortunately, we don't have our personal part with coffee and cakes, so that's how you can proceed later if you are more interested in this topic. So thank you again, Gerald. It was really a pleasure for me and for Center for Theoretical Physics to hear your seminar, and hopefully see you next time in person.
Yeah,
and stay in good health.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.